Morning. Nice to see you. Great. Well, I do want to thank Joyce very much for asking me to take part in her conference here. It really has been great getting to know her and her husband and her family and her colleagues. It's just been great. Hasn't she got potential? It really is fantastic. It's always difficult when people ask me, what do I do? Because if I say I'm an evangelist, that's a little bit of a loaded term, and it means different things to different people. If I say that I'm a canon in the Church of England, which I am, what does that mean? So I try to be a little bit creative in explaining what I do. And last year, I sat down next to this lady on a plane at Heathrow Airport. Hello, hello, where are you going? She says, I'm going to Singapore. She says, where are you going? I said, I'm going to Perth, Australia. Oh, what do you do? And she was the vice president of a designer clothing company. And then she says, what do you do? And I said, well, I work for a global enterprise. She said, do you? I said, yes, I do. I said, we've got outlets in nearly every country of the world. I said, we run orphanages. We've got hospitals, hospices. We do marriage guidance counselling. We have schools, colleges, universities, publishing companies. I said, we look after people from birth to death, and we deal in the area of behavioural alteration. She said, wow. I said, I know what you mean. She says, what's it called? I said, it's called Christianity. It is so important to remind ourselves that we are part of something global. And not only is it global, but it's intergalactic, because it includes all those that have gone before us. Now, I'm Greek. It actually is all Greek to me. And a very popular Greek meal is called mezes. Mezes is when you have a lot of very different little dishes that make up the whole meal. And what I'm going to do in this session now is I'm going to give you spiritual mezes. So I'm going to give you a number of little different dishes, and maybe some of you are going to just take from one, others of you are going to take from two or three and more. But I'm going to offer you a number. The first one I'm going to offer you is prayer. Prayer. There was a minister with his family in the garden one hot, sunny Saturday afternoon, and they were playing with their little kitten. And the kitten went up a tree and it got stuck between two branches and couldn't get its head out. They tried to get the little kitten down, but they couldn't get to it because of all the branches and the tree. But the father, being a pastor, always came up with great ideas. He says, don't worry, daddy to the rescue. I'm going to get a rope, I'm going to get my car. I'm going to tie the rope round the tree, I'm going to tie it onto the car. I'll get in the car, I'll drive a bit, that'll bring the tree down, and we'll be able to maneuver and get the little pussycat down. Everyone said, daddy to the rescue. Daddy got his car, he got the rope. He tied the rope round the tree, he tied it onto the car. He began to drive, slowly, slowly. The tree's bending, bending. The car's moving, the tree's bending, and then the rope snapped. As the rope snapped, the tree flung back And the little kitten went flying out in the opposite direction. And that's the end of the story. 2 weeks later, the pastor is visiting a member of his congregation. He knocked on the door. The lady says, "Pastor, come in." He walks in. There in the hallway was his little kitten. It was unmistakable. It was his kitten. But he didn't want to say, "That's my little kitten." So he said to her, "That's a lovely little kitten you've got. Have you had her long?" She said, "Pastor, you're not going to believe this. But it was 2 weeks ago. It was a hot, sunny Saturday afternoon. And I was in my garden with my little daughter, Annie. And Annie said, 'Mummy, please, can we have a kitten?' And I said, 'No, no. We're not having a kitten.' But she pestered me and pestered me. The only thing I could think of saying was, 'Annie, let's kneel down in the garden and let's pray to the Lord Jesus. And if the Lord Jesus wants you to have a kitten, he'll send you a kitten.' Pastor, you're not going to believe this." When we pray, coincidences happen, and when we don't, they don't. Repeat that after me. When we pray, I said after me. When we pray, coincidences happen. When we don't, they don't. Our lives need to be characterized by prayer. It is so, so important that we are prayerful, that all that we are and all that we do is birthed in prayer. Because we don't want to be driven, we want to be led. And it is so important. You know, so many of us have got so many irons in the fire, we've actually put the fire out. You know, I went to the toilet, I came out the toilet, I went into the kitchen, I said to my wife, "I'm having a breakdown." She says, "Well, how do you know?" I said, "Because I flushed the toilet before I started." I was in such a hurry. I walked in, I flushed it, so that I wouldn't have to flush it afterwards. Our lives, they're so manic. We're driven. You know, we're running around like a headless chicken. You know, some of us, you know, we can't put more irons in the fire. What we need to do is take some irons out, stoke up the fire. And we stoke up the fire in prayer. Perspective is so, so important. It really is. I have a number of my books out over there in the book area, and I have a collection, 3 volumes that I did with my pastor, full of stories and anecdotes and illustrations. In one of those is this letter. A girl went off to college and she didn't contact her parents for a long time and then felt really bad about it. And then she wrote this letter. "Dear Mum and Dad, since I left for college, I've been remiss in writing, and I'm sorry for my thoughtlessness in not having written before. I'll bring you up to date, but before I do, please sit down. It's important that you sit down before you read on. I'm getting along pretty well now. The skull fracture and concussion I got when I jumped out of my dormitory window when it caught on fire shortly after my arrival. It has pretty well healed. I only get those sick headaches a couple of times a day. Fortunately, an attendant at the petrol station witnessed the fire in my dorm and the jump. He ran over, took me to hospital, and continued to visit me there. When I got out of the hospital, I had nowhere to live because of the burnt-out conditions of my room, so he was kind enough to invite me to share his basement bedroom flat with him. It's sort of small, but very cute. He is a very fine boy, and we have fallen deeply in love, and we are planning to get married. We haven't set the exact date yet, but it will be before my pregnancy begins to show. Yes, Mum and Dad, I'm pregnant. I know how much you are looking forward to being grandparents, and I know you will welcome the baby and give it the same tender care and devotion that you gave me when I was a child. The reason for the delay in our marriage is that my boyfriend has an infection which I carelessly caught from him. I know, however, that you will welcome him into our family with open arms. He is kind, and although not well-educated, he is ambitious. Although he is of a different race and religion than ours, I know that your often expressed tolerance will not permit you to be bothered by that. In conclusion, now that I brought you up to date, I want to tell you there was no dormitory fire. I did not have concussion. I do not have skull fracture. I was not in the hospital. I am not pregnant. I do not have an infection, and there is no boyfriend in my life. However, I have failed history and science. However, I have failed history and science, and I wanted you to see these results in their proper perspective. Well, you know, you can imagine getting a letter like that and the... you know, and freaking out, can't you? But can you imagine if you got a letter, dear Mum and Dad, I'm sorry I've not been in touch, but I failed all my exams. What do you mean you failed your exams? What do you mean you failed your exams? But when you read a letter like that, you'll say, darling, you can fail the lot. It's fine. You see, perspective is so, so important. Perspective. God sees what we can't. God sees what we can't. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. Right, it doesn't say all things are good, because a lot of things are not good, but all things can work together for good. And so it's important for us to say, God, we want to see what we can't. Help us to gain your perspective. What is your perspective? And as we do that, we'll see things differently. I think this is one of the great gifts that Joyce brings to us. She illuminates some simple things in life, and then we, all right, I see it. When David saw Goliath, there were two possible reactions. The first reaction was, he's really big. Oh no, I better run away. The second reaction, he's really big. How can I miss? You see, it's a matter of perspective. Now, what we need to be people whose lives are characterized by prayer, who are people who are seeking God's perspective, not our own narrow, limited perspective. Purpose. So many people lack direction in their lives. Many people suffer from the Columbus syndrome. Columbus set off and he didn't know where he was going. When he got there, he didn't know where he was. And then when he got back, he didn't know where he'd been. You know, it's important for us to have some kind of, well, what is it? What is it? If you had to sum up, you know, there are 800,000 words in the Bible. Well, what is it? What is it? What's the strap line? What is it about? Well, in the words of the Apostle Paul, to know Christ and to make him known. That's it. Those are the two bookends. To know Christ, make him known. And then everything's in between. They're the two things. That's our strap line. That's our purpose. So it doesn't matter what we do, who we are, where we live. The bookends are knowing Christ, making him known, and the in-between, unpacking it, those two bookends, and making it real and relevant to our lives, our marriage, our family, our work, our leisure, everything. That's the strap line. To know Christ and to make him known. It is all about Jesus. Jesus. I tell you, the most important book I've written is called The Life. It's all about Jesus. And that's available if you're interested afterwards in the book area. Do you know, very few Christians have ever read a book about Jesus. Do you know that what's remarkable is that for every 100 books that are ever published by Christian publishers, only one is about Jesus. But it is all about Jesus. It's Jesus. He's the one. Jesus is the one. And in many different ways, he articulated that. I am the bread of life, so that bakers can understand. I am the true vine, so that gardeners can understand. He's the way, so that traffic wardens can understand. He's the truth, so that politicians can understand. He's the resurrection, so that funeral directors can understand. He's the good shepherd, so that farmers can understand. He's the door, so that architects can understand. He's the Alpha and the Omega, so that scientists can understand. He's the living water, so that plumbers can understand. He's the word, so that the actors can understand. Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one. You know, if you're walking down a street and you get to the end of the street, it branches into two. You don't know which way to go. Left, right, I don't know. There are two men lying there. One's dead, one's alive. Which one would you ask for directions? Jesus is alive. Jesus is the one. It's all about Jesus. You know, my book on Jesus, I gave it to Yasser Arafat. I met with him. I said, Yasser. Well, I didn't actually. I know. In fact, when I first met him, I thought, why are you wearing a tea towel on your head? But anyway, but I thought, don't say that. Anyway, I said, could I give you this book about Jesus? Could I give you this book about the greatest leader and reconciler to be born in Palestine? And then he took the book and he said, ah, Jesus. I said, that's right, Jesus. Jesus. I had to preach him a sermon. There was the chief Islamic lawyer, there was him, there was another, he asked me, preach me a sermon now. So I had to get up, and there's only three. I got up, he stood up. So I stood next to him. I said, can I tell you a story? He says, I like stories. So I told him the whole gospel story in story form. Story form. Jesus is the one, the unique one. You see, we're prayerful people who have a perspective, who have a purpose, who live by priorities. If we don't live by priorities, we're going to live by pressures. And that's why it's important that we know what the priorities are. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. Repeat after me. The main thing is to keep after me. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. So important that we discern that. And a conference like this gives us the opportunity to somehow distill so much and allow us to, hey, Lord, what are my priorities? What is it? How do I work those out within the two bookends? Prayerfully, with a perspective that's yours, not my own limited horizon. Partnership. I was speaking at a conference for leaders. This is a true story. And as I was speaking, I wanted to use an analogy about snowflakes. And I just said, as a little throwaway, you know people say that no two snowflakes are alike. I said, who on earth does all the research? I finished speaking, and this man came up to me afterwards. He says, J.John, I'm Dr. So-and-so. He says, I'm a research snowflake scientist. I said, no, you're not. He says, yes, I am. I said, you're not. He says, I am. I said, people like that don't exist. He says, well, I've been doing it for 16 years, and I can tell you I do exist. Anyway, it turned out the guy was a research snowflake scientist. And I said, I can't believe it. I said, well, is it true that no two snowflakes are alike? He says, yes, it is. He says, I'll tell you something else to blow your mind. You take two snowflakes, they're completely different. You put them into two test tubes. You melt them, they'll go into water. You recrystallize them, they will always go back to their original formation. Now, here was the analogy that I wanted to use. It was this. When a snowflake falls onto your face during wintertime, it melts incredibly quickly. But when you get thousands of snowflakes together, they can stop traffic. On our own, even though we're unique, distinctively unique, on our own, we're very fragile. And that is why it is so important that we don't live Christianity, practice Christianity solitary. It's not just about me and my own journey. We've got to realize, in the words of Augustine, you cannot have God as your father without having the church as your mother. Even though she's flawed, we're part of it, and she's the bride, and Jesus is preparing the bride. And it's very important for us to be in community with each other. So important. Be prayerful. Gain God's perspective. Be clear on the purpose. Live by priorities, not by pressures. Realize that it's not just about me on my own. I'm part of a bigger thing. I'm part of a partnership. Provision. There was a man at an airport, and he wanted to buy a bag of very small donuts and a coffee. So he buys his bag of small donuts and he buys his coffee, and he's looking for somewhere to sit, but all the tables are all taken. But there's one table where there's one man sitting, and he thinks, oh, I'll just go and sit opposite him. So he goes there, he puts his coffee down, he puts his bags down, he gets his coat off, puts it on the chair, sits down, opens his coffee, has a sip. Picks up the bag of donuts, opens it, takes out a donut, starts eating it, puts the bag down. The man opposite stretches over, picks up the bag of donuts, opens it, takes out a donut, starts eating it, puts the bag down, smiles. The other man cannot believe what he has just seen. He cannot believe that the man has just stolen one of his donuts. He's thinking, what is the world coming to? What is the world? But then he thinks, well, maybe, you know, the guy's not quite there, or, you know, he better not say anything in case the guy kind of erupts and he's violent. But he gives him one of these, if looks could kill look. He picks up the bag of donuts, he takes out another donut, and he moves it near to his coffee, as far away from the other man. While he's sipping his coffee, the man stretches over, picks up the bag, takes out another donut, starts eating it, puts it on the table, pushes it back, smiles. The other guy can't believe it. He's done it twice. He's stolen two of my donuts. He's amazed. He can't believe it. He's really angry, but he decides not to say anything. Anyway, the man gets up to leave. So the other man thinks, it's about time you left, you donut thief. He put his coat on, he picked up his bag, he then picked up the bag of donuts. There's one donut inside. He takes it out, he breaks it in half, he puts half in his mouth, puts half on the bag, he moves the bag, he smiles, he waves, off he goes. The other guy thinks, I'm not touching that donut, you donut thief. You're probably full of infection. Anyway, he looks at his watch. Oh, it's time for me to go. He gets up, he puts his coat on, He then bends down to pick up his bag, and sitting on top of his bag was his bag of donuts. He was complaining that the other man was stealing his donuts, when in fact the other man was sharing his donuts. Now, listen to me. God owns all the donuts. And we're complaining, and God owns all of them. He owns all the donuts. Listen, every week we get a bag of donuts. God gives us a bag of donuts every week. Inside there are 10. God says, take one of the 10 and give it to the church that you go to. Okay, that's called tithing. Okay? So, you give a donut to the church that you go to. Right? They're God's donuts, so don't complain. They're all God's donuts. He just says, give one to the church that you're part of. So important, isn't it? Yeah, that now you're left with 9 and you need 11. Hey, I need 11. I've just given one away. I've only got 9. And what is incredible is if you need 11 or you need 12, somehow the 9 becomes 12. Somehow the 9 becomes what you need. Honestly, a lot of people in Britain haven't heard the Sermon on the Mount. They haven't. Honestly, a lot of British Christians squeeze the pound so tightly they make the Queen cry. You got 10 donuts. God says, give a donut to the church that you go to. You got 9 now. See? 9. Some of us need more, and it either stretches or somebody comes along and says, could I give you 2 donuts? And you say, oh, yes, please. Now, some of us got 10 donuts. We give 1 to the church. Now we're left with 9. And we don't need 9. There are many people here, I would say thousands of us here, that do need, we need 11. But I would reckon there are thousands of us here who don't even need 9. And so what does God say? Right, I want you to give a donut to Joyce Meyer so that she can go on TV every day. So you give one of your donuts and you become a monthly supporter. Yeah? And then something else happens. You know, there's a need or this orphanage or compassion or world vision. And you think, oh, yeah. And God says, give a donut. Listen, we all get the quiver in the liver. And you and I cannot outgive God. And when you act on it, he responds. So what we've got to do is to say, Lord, they're all your donuts. What do you want me to do with them? What do you want me to do with them? And if you've got a spare donut, give it to me. I'll have it. These are all interlinked principles. It's like segments of an orange that our lives need to be prayerful. That we need to be people that have his perspective, his purpose, living his priorities, realizing that we're in partnership. But provision is so important. It's just part of the whole thing. And we cannot outgive God. We cannot outgive God. Let's be generous with our time. Let's be generous with our talents. Let's be generous with our treasure, because it's God's time, it's God's talents, and it's God's treasure. Passion. Passion. Passion for what? Well, during this conference, what have we done? We've looked up. We've looked up in our worship. We've looked up. We've looked in. We've looked in. That's what Joyce is, a gift from God to the church to help us to look in so that we can sort so much. You know, we've all got rucksacks full of hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And God has sent her to help us sort all of that out. We look up, we look in, we look out. We look out, we look out, we look out. In the process of looking up and looking in, we look out. It's all right. The three are all interlinked. We've got to look out. Because time is short. And there are millions of people who haven't got a clue about what we know. We know. I mean, do you agree that Jesus is the unique one? Yes, you agree. Do you agree that Jesus is the only one that can give people forgiveness?
Yes.
Do you agree that that's what people need in Britain and in Europe and in the world today? They need forgiveness. Yes? Do you agree they need new life today that only the Holy Spirit can give? Yes? Do you believe that people need a hope for the future? They do, but most people don't have a hope. Most people's hope is a bit like a hospital gown. You're usually not as well covered as you think you are. They're all hopeless. See, you and I, we know the answer. We know that to have forgiveness from the past, to have new life today, and to have a hope for the future, you've got to go via King's Cross. There is no other route. You can't get there via Birmingham. You can't get there via the Church of England. You've got to go via King's Cross. You've got to go via the cross of the King. We know that, but loads of people don't know that. A missionary is not someone who crosses the sea. A missionary is someone who sees the cross. Repeat that. Just repeat it after me. A missionary is not someone who crosses the sea.
A missionary is someone who sees the cross.
Because if you've seen the cross, you've understood it. And in the words of the Apostle Paul in Corinthians, the love of Christ compels me. What is it that compels me? It is the love of Christ that compels me to share this good news with other people. In the words of St. Francis of Assisi's prayer, in giving we receive. And we need to be people who are giving out to others the good news, to other people, because they are lost. They are lost. Just imagine my wife and I and our three sons. We decide to go to a forest for a day to have a day's picnic, play games. We have a great time, and it's time to leave. So my wife and I pack everything up, put it all in the car, and when we do, we realize we've only got Benjamin with us, our youngest. We've lost Simeon, we've lost Michael, our other two sons. So my wife and I think, well, let's go into the forest and search for them. We search round, we only find Simeon, we can't find Michael. So we say, well, never mind, let's just go home. Well, you know what I mean, win some, lose some. Well, we lost two, but we got one back. Sometimes you got to count your losses. Haven't you? No! We would search for Michael until we found him alive or dead. That's the kind of an analogy that is used in the Bible to compel us to seek and save the lost. You see, in the process of looking up, in the process of looking in, we have to be looking out. We have to be doing all three at the same time. Looking up, looking in, looking out. The whole time. The more we look out, the more we're sorted within. The more we're sorted within, the more we look out. The more we look up, the more we're able to look out. It's like a three-legged stool. And many of us sometimes concentrate on one or two, but not all three. It is so important. We've got to be intentional. We've got to be intentional about this. The other day, I had an appointment in London, in Canary Wharf, and I didn't want to be late. So I made sure I wasn't late for this appointment. And you arrive in the underground, and the underground, when you come out, it goes into a shopping mall. So I got out into the shopping mall, and I looked at my watch. I thought, oh, great, I'm half an hour early. That's great. I'll go and have a little coffee before my meeting. As I'm walking, I see a man who's a shoe shine man. He does the shoes. And I thought, oh, I'll get my shoes cleaned. I look down. Oh, they're clean. I don't need to get them cleaned. I had a real prompting in my spirit. Get them cleaned. I thought, I don't need them cleaned. I felt it. Get them cleaned. So I thought, okay. So I said, excuse me, sir, how much is it to get the shoes cleaned? He said, £4. I thought, £4 to get a pair of clean shoes cleaned? But I felt the Lord say, get them cleaned. I said, yes, please. I sat up on there and I said to him, why are you sad? I didn't even say what's your name or anything. We had no little introductions. I said, why are you sad? He looked up. He said, how do you know I'm sad? I said, I can see it in your eyes. He said, I am very sad. I said, sir, tell me your story. He said, tell me your story. He says, I have cleaned hundreds of shoes here over the years. You are the first person to ever say to me, tell me your story. I said, I'd like to hear your story. Do you know, no other person came. For 25 minutes, he told me a story. For 25 minutes, we interacted. The guy was weeping. He was weeping. I said to him, look, I've got to go in a minute because I've got an appointment. But could I say a prayer for you? He said, I would like that very much. Right, this is in the shopping mall. You know, people are walking up and down. And so I said, do you mind if I just lay my hand on your chest as I say a prayer for you? He said, no, of course not. And I prayed a very simple prayer. A very simple prayer. Father God, help. Help. Do this, do that. I didn't go over the top. I didn't kind of, rubber dinghy. Oh, she came on a Honda. She came on a Honda. You know, she came on a Honda. When did she come on a Honda? Now, look, there are times I speak in tongues. But sometimes, for the sake of the lost, yeah, you say a little prayer. I said a little prayer on the inside, on the inside. Lord, smack him. On the inside. Get him. And the shoe man's like this. He'd never been to Toronto. He didn't know about all that. It's being intentional about it. That is the important thing. Being intentional about it. God has asked us to cultivate the web of relationships that we have already got. I went after that. I gave him, always be prepared. Opened my bag. I gave him a whole bunch of stuff. I said, like, do this. I said, I've got to go. Went to my appointment, finished my appointment, was walking to the train station. I was a little bit hungry. So, I'll go and have a little sandwich. So I went into a cafe, got a sandwich. I was looking for somewhere to sit. All tables are full. There was one table with one man. I said, excuse me, do you mind if I sit here? He said, no, not at all. I said, cool, it's really busy. He says, oh, you obviously don't work around here. I said, no. And I'm just visiting. And I said, I don't know, I just had this prompting to say, excuse me, are you married? I just felt it. Are you married? He said, oh, He says, that is a most fascinating question. He says, you're not going to believe this. I've been engaged for 9 years and I can't get my act together. I said, well, you better get your act together. I gave him a little bit of a pre-marital marriage guidance counselling. I said, listen, look, I've written a book on marriage, but I haven't got it with me. But here's my business card, right? If you want the book on marriage, you email me and I will send it to you. And I said, look, I've got to go now. It's just a little bit of a seed, little bit of seed, little bit of seed, little bit of... Right? So I went back to my office. I went back to my office and there in the office, email. What a delightful time it was to meet you at lunchtime. Yes, please send me the book. I sent him the book. He emailed back. He says, my fiance's read the book. I'm now reading the book. We need to resolve a few things. And hey ho, little bit of Jesus. You know, listen, you don't have to get up in the morning and go, oh, where are the non-Christians? Maybe they're round here. They're round here. I don't know. Where are they? Listen, non-Christians are everywhere. Everywhere. I was on the underground in London. On the underground, sitting there, my eye caught the eye of the guy opposite. I smiled. Without the eyebrow. He got up, he walked over, sat next to me. He said, it's very unusual to smile on the underground. I said, I know. I said, the problem is, if you smile on the underground, you're either a very nice person or you have a slightly different orientation. I said, I can assure you I'm a very nice person. I said, where are you getting off? He told me. I said, oh, I'm getting off 2 stops after you. He said to me, what do you do? Remember, we've only got 5 stops. I can't give him the long version. I gave him the short version. I'm a motivational speaker for behavioural alteration. I said, what do you do? He says, I'm an ambassador. I thought, pull the other one. I said, do you have a business card? He says, yes, I do. He opened his briefcase, got a business card. The guy's an ambassador. I had a little chat with him. I said, well, sir, I opened my briefcase. I said, could I give you this book about Jesus? I believe that Jesus is the key to life. I believe what he came and taught is what makes a difference in life. And I build my life on his values, his principles. Off he goes, right? Next day, I get a phone call from the ambassador. He says, I was so intrigued to meet you. I went straight to my office and I said to my secretary, cancel all my engagements. I want to read this book. He went to his office. Listen to this. He went to his office. He read the book. He got to the end of the book. This is the same book I gave Yasser. Same book, yeah? He read the book. He prayed to receive Christ at the end. And he said to me, what do I do now? Right. Let's reenact it. How did this work? Excuse me, could I give you a book? I don't think some of you got that. You've probably missed it. It goes like this. Excuse me, could I give you a book? What, you're telling me one smile, one book did it? Yes! One smile, one book did it! As I draw to a conclusion, listen. Hold all these things together. While you're looking up, you're looking in, look out. Be prayerful. Get God's perspective. Know what the priorities are. Be passionate to seek and save the lost. Don't worry about what you can't do. Do what you can do. That's the thing. You know, we are living in exciting times. In exciting times. There were 2 Jews that met. And I conclude with this. One said to the other, how are you? He says, I'm not good. He says, why not? He said, my son, he's become a Christian. His friend says, oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian.
Yeah.
What do we do?
Well, let's go and see the rabbi.
Rabbi, we've come to you with our problems.
The rabbi says, what are your problems?
He said, our sons, they've become Christians.
The rabbi went, oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian.
Yeah. What do we do, rabbi?
Rabbi thinks for a moment. In a situation like this, we go to the chief rabbi.
Chief rabbi, we've come to you with our problems.
Chief rabbi says, what are your problems? They said, all our sons, they've all become Christians. The chief rabbi went, oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian.
Yeah. What do we do?
Chief rabbi thinks for a moment. He says, in a situation like this, we go to Yahweh. We bow down to Yahweh. We call on the name of Yahweh. We tell Yahweh our problems. They went to Yahweh. They bowed down. They said, Yahweh,
we come to you with our problems.
They heard from heaven. What are your problems?
They said, all our sons have all become Christians.
And then they heard, it's funny you should say that.
God had one son, and his son was a missionary. I want to be like that.
Thank you. Awesome.